Hello, Grand Rising, good day, and good evening to you, wherever in the world you are. I would like, in these few minutes, to tell your story and gain your support for this campaign. My name is Damilola Oshilaja. I'm speaking not only for myself, but also for those who, in varying degrees, would have experienced the effects of the tale that I'm about to tell you. And indeed, for those who don't have a voice. So to support this campaign, all you need to do is sign this petition attached. If you're watching this video on Change.org, if you're watching this video on YouTube or any other social media, you can click the associated link to Change.org and sign the petition to support the campaign. You can also follow the associated social media pages. If you're watching this on Instagram, you can go to the page and follow. Or on Facebook, you can do the same. And quite easily as well, you can share this video. You can click the share button anywhere on the page. If you're receiving this or watching this through WhatsApp, you can forward this on. And likewise, I thank you for your support. If you would like to do more, you can make a donation on the official GoFundMe page for this campaign, or you can show your support by buying and acquiring my art in its various forms. There are links to my website, grungestudios.com, where you can make inquiries and see more of my body of work. There are links on this page and other associated pages that this video is broadcasting. I'd like to say a few things about myself and the title of this petition. The title being Abominable Inconsistencies at World Leading Creative Institutions. The title of this campaign reflects quite succinctly what I have experienced, and it encapsulates what needs to be put right. In light of myself, as you are viewing me, wherever you are, the first thing that would come to your mind is that you would resolve to a conclusion that I am black, and that I would class as a colloquial term, sort of a popular term of my description, although that description is very much falling short in many ways to encapsulate who I am and what I am. For the record, I am not black. As an artist, I work with colors, and black is a color on my palette, and it's an adjective. It describes or qualifies further something. Colors necessarily aren't entirely physical substances. You know, they are attributes to something. Therefore, I can't be black just by definition of the word. I am neither an adjective nor an abstract thing. I'm a physical, real entity called man. That's what I believe. Having said that, and just before this part of the film, there was a short scene focused on the computer screen just behind me here of this painting. I will come back to this painting and relate the petition and the story to it.
I am a man with dual nationality. I am both Nigerian and British. I was born in London, in England. I was born in the 1980s, and I have lived more than 80% of my life in the United Kingdom and in Europe in general. And pretty much my development, my growth has been here in the United Kingdom. And in view of the title of the petition, Abominable Inconsistencies at World-Leading Creative Institutions, I think that the population of the United Kingdom that would be classed as quote-unquote black or of African descent, I would actually say of African ascent, right? Because we are on the land, you know, and we rose up because we grew baby into adulthood, so we ascend, you know, we don't, strictly speaking, descend. So yes, people of African ascent, or people designated as quote-unquote black, amount to about 3% or so of the population of the United Kingdom. Nevertheless, I feel like the panoply of output and effort made in whatever field of practice or study, it seems to me, or it is suggested to me, that none or hardly any of the 3% contingent of the United Kingdom population have a material contribution to the way the economy and the society works, in that most of the people that control policy, control budgets, control curriculums, control the administration and the dissemination of education, knowledge, skills, are not representational of that 3%. I mean, overwhelmingly, in major institutions, and especially in my field of creative industries, overwhelmingly, the people who are responsible for management, full stop, do not look like me. And and one would be hard-pressed to find a section in these institutions where my image as man is represented. I think this is an abnormality. This is incongruent. It cannot be true that an entire peoples cannot contribute in a significant way to the way things are done. Right? There is a corruption of thought here in this regard. Right? And this is my personal experience. I have gone through something quite revelational for me. It's quite a revelation, a huge revelation for me, that has brought me to this point to make this video. And necessarily so, I feel that if I bring this story to light, something will change. So I want to start with a little backstory, and then I will come back to you and resolve to what this is all about. Thanks for watching.
So after my mother gave birth, this is the first place to call home, somewhere in Northwest London. From here, I traveled to Nigeria as a toddler, where I spent my early years. Here I am, around 4 years old, on your right side of the picture, with my brother seated on the floor and my cousins to my right hand side. My early life in Lagos is a wonderful and challenging story for another occasion. However, I began my journey in art at the age of 7. I arrived back in London as a 16-year-old unaccompanied and started life as an artist living in my apartment above a hairdresser's in Crystal Palace. During this time, I did my utmost to establish an art practice, having a first solo show in 1998 while I was still in college doing my A-levels. Here's a shot of my old college picture, and there I am on the left-hand side of the picture in the second row, third person from the end. And here are some shots from my solo show in 1998, along with some earlier work. Over the next 12 years, after that exhibition just pictured, I engaged myself with the moves, activities, and costs needed to manifest the artist life I designed and desired. London is my home city. I have a unique connection to this place. Beyond being born in London, the place where I arrived in life is 5 minutes round the corner from Tate Britain, one of the most powerful institutions for art in the world. In 2010, 10 years ago, I enrolled on a Master of Arts program at Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design, one of the colleges of University of the Arts London, which is second in the list of top creative schools in the world, formerly number one. I was going on to the program 13 years after practice of, you know, my art and developing my own studios. You know, so I took it as a professional accreditation program. You know, I was very different from about 80% of my peers on the program who came onto the course, the degree immediately after a BA. In fine art, you know, I had done my first degree 8 years earlier. Although I considered myself an artist in my own right, you know, I kept an open mind, notwithstanding my own established identity. More than anything, I was enthused by the opportunity for studio space, something very rare in London. And here I was in the heart of central London with more space than I previously had. It was literally a dream come true. My focus had always been the environment, the body, and that in between, and I was planning and looking forward to advancements in this field.
Hello again. I'd like to pause and flesh out some details for you. I hope you've enjoyed backstory so far. At the time of enrolling at Central St. Martin's, I didn't quite realize the magnitude of my presence within this institution. So I'd like to give you a little history, if you're not familiar, about Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design. Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design came into existence in 1989. That was the year that brand of creative institution began its life. Before that, it was alive in two different strands, because you see, the institution is a merger of two independent art colleges. So in 1854, the St. Martin's School of Art was founded. In 1898, the Central School of Art and Design was established by the London County Council. and it was not until 1989 that these two entities, St. Martin's School of Art and the Central School of Art and Design, merged to form this entity. So it has been in existence for well over 100 years. But the EMIC program had only been running for just about over two decades or so. I, at the time, out of 81 students, was the only one of my kind, I mean the Afro-Asiatic kind, amongst the cohort of students. At the same time, it was likely that I was the first male artist painter of my kind, that is the Afro-Asiatic kind, since the university, the college, began in 1989, because you would have to go back to the late 80s to find another male Afro-Asiatic artist painter to occupy the building. I think the artist at that time would have been Inconsistency Barry, MBE, a very famous artist that many of you may or may not be aware of. You know, art schools are funny places, and the goings-ons of these places don't usually come out to light. We are in special times, so I'm just going to tell you what my experience is, so that you understand what this campaign is about. I mean, I didn't really feel any way about being the only one of my kind on the program. You see, all I wanted to do and all I was thinking about was furthering my dream. And my dream was to be the best artist that I could be of myself. Not measuring myself against any other artist, definitely not trying to be any other artist, but myself. Within the time that I live and within the environments that I'm fortunate to experience. You know, throughout my time there, I was working on seven paintings, which was signaled by the 2010 BP oil explosion. You know, it was a painterly examination of our world's dependency on oil. Especially from the point of view of Africa. These seven oil explosion paintings were planned and worked to be shown at the exhibition at the end, which is called a graduate exhibition. The system is set up to test the conviction of the artist, and not just to produce an output or an outcome, but to test the conviction of the artist at every level, to test the conviction technically, philosophically, and ideologically. However, I had gone through the meal of testing my convictions in the open world without any real support, just a brush, a dream, and ideas to execute. I had experienced many things that most of my colleagues on the program had not. And that's likely why I was able to continue with my work, albeit evolve the work, but not change my identity or my conviction, because I didn't feel it was necessary to be changed. I, at a very young age, at the age of 16, had discovered who I wanted to be as an artist, and that person was someone who was going to have to travel over time to achieve the many destinations. So if they call me a rapper, okay, yeah, I can dig it. But if they bring me for the times, then I can kick it. I wasn't prepared by the tests. I get wicked. I get the highest. I answered everything, not just adequate, but excellent. as a result of being adept with who I am. I guess it contributed to my pace of production, although the works took very, very long times to complete. I finished with enough time spare to create another work, which was part of my idea generation machine. And I created the work, and in the process I was challenged by the course director and a tutor assigned to me to work with about whether or not I would be able to finish that final piece, which is this painting over here, and whether or not I had discussed with anyone about the piece. And I promptly responded to them by saying that I would finish, and that I had spoken to both of them about it. So what I'd like to do right now is take you back to the whiteboard and carry on the story.
It's the MA Fine Art Graduate Exhibition, the final exhibition of the year. And if you can imagine a gallery that I'm assigned, that all the participants, all the artists on the MA program are assigned a gallery to showcase their works they've been working on throughout the year. I want to give you an idea of what the graduate exhibition was like and what it looked like. So this is a mock example of that graduate exhibition that I experienced in 2011. This is what the gallery space would have been like, and each artist would have been invigilating the space. There would have been two people to share a space divided by a dividing wall. And this image is actually an image of a real work of art that I created for that MA graduate exhibition. It's called Landscape Redox Deep Water Mark II. And I'm setting up for the final piece. There are six of my works up, and in walks Andrew Bick, and he's the personal tutor assigned to me. And he sees me on the floor assembling this piece, this final piece I'm going to put up, and he says to me, "You can't finish." You know, and I say to him, "Well, you can see all the other pieces are assembled. This is the last one, and I'm just about to put it up." And then he goes away and then comes back into my gallery with Alex Landrum, who's the course director for the MA 2010-2011 year. And Alex comes in, walks around through my gallery, sees all the other paintings up on the wall, and says to me, "Dami Lola, you know, this is a distinction level work. You've already got a distinction, but if you put that painting that you're working on the floor, if you put it up and hang it up, I'm going to mark you down to a pass." Now, while all this is going on, unbeknownst to me at the time, my friend Mu Tian, who's from China, also on the course, and had his gallery next door to me, was observing all of this. The piece, the painting in question, is called Chip Surface 2 Ichiban Corpus Negra. And Ichiban is Japanese for first, and Corpus Negra, as it suggests, is called body dark. And this is the painting that caused all the fuss. Anyhow, I put the painting up, I finished it, as you can see, and the tale progressed onto the fact that he came through with his threat, and I got some pieces of paper marked as a pass. It was very disappointing, as you can imagine, because I believed I was working on distinction level, and Mr. Landrum did confirm that. So, the following year, I graduated with a pass. I was advised not to appeal the decision at the time by parties that belonged to the institution. That's just another story in itself, the tale of wanting to appeal the very, very, very inequitable grade that I was given. But the story carries on in the next scene.
In order to lend your support adequately, efficiently, and truthfully, you really need to appreciate what this is all about. And in order to appreciate what this is all about, by the end of this tale, which I hope you will be giving your very valued support to this initiative, you really need to appreciate the painting, the work of art in question, Chip Surface 2 Ichiban Corpus Negra. So I want to give you a bird's eye view of the image. Now, with the power of video, I want to take you to my graduate show and actually show you the exhibition in film.
I want a sunny kind of love, a love to last past Saturday night. And I like to know it's more than love at first sight. I want a Sunday kind of love. I want a love that's on the square. Can't seem to find somebody, somebody to care. I'm on a lonely road, sure enough, that leads to nowhere. I need a sunny kind of love. I do my sunny dreaming out all of my Sunday screaming. Every minute, every hour, every day. Oh, I'm hoping to discover a certain kind of love who will show me the way into my arms. I need someone to unfold, to keep me warm when Mondays and Tuesdays grow cold. The love of my life, all I want is that sunny kind of love. I don't want a Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, or Thursday, or Friday, or Saturday. I just want nothing but that sunny kind of love. I want a sunny kind of love. Sunday kind of love.
Now ask yourself, after you've seen all that has just come before, whether I merit a distinction, which is the highest grade achievement, or pass, which is the second lowest grade. Also take note that over the course of a year, I was the student representative for my entire academic year. There's a certificate that's going to come on the screen confirming that honor that I held and the skills that I showcased are confirmed as a result of holding the position. And regardless of the unjustified treatment that I received, I pushed on with my work and I carried on with my practice. I was not going to be fazed by what I thought was unjustifiable and inequitable and just a low blow, as far as I'm concerned. And I tried to do this by applying for a PhD at the Royal College of Art, which is the number one creative school in the world. And initially I got accepted. I got an acceptance letter. But within weeks of that acceptance letter, I got a rejection letter telling me that the acceptance was given to me in error and that they had to unfortunately revoke the place. Even though, you know, the offer made was already accepted and the like and so forth. And, you know, I had never experienced anything like that before. So I decided to engineer a meeting with one of the people in the department called the School of Art. And I was able to get a meeting with one of the professors there, a professor by the name of Rebecca Fortnum. And she was very diplomatic and graceful about seeing me and listening to my concerns. You know, she said to me that she also had never heard of a situation like that before and she couldn't explain it. However, she cannot deny that there is institutional discrimination and prejudice, which is rife in most institutions, not just in the creative industries. And she simply advised me to reapply. And I have reapplied every year since 2013. Maybe apart from a year or two, I think I've made a series of consecutive applications, including the current application for the academic year to come. I have yet to receive a response from that application. I'm sure the current world situation has something to do with it. Nonetheless, that application is live. And I am yet to receive my place that was originally offered to me. Although the responses of being accepted and rejected was in 2014, I didn't actually engineer a meeting or get a meeting until 2017. The chain of events of being accepted and then being rejected, coming on the back of the experience I had on the MA program at Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design, was a lot to deal with psychologically and spiritually. And so I took a break from the development of my career and my practice by going to teach for a while, teaching in education secondary school. And it wasn't satisfying, not in the way that I thought it would be. Not that I didn't enjoy the process of the mechanics of teaching. I just didn't appreciate the administration of a teacher's role. There are a lot of redundant activities attached to being a teacher in most countries. So I decided in 2014-15 to go back to my practice and go back to my studio work. And in the process of developing new work, I reignited my fire for my work and saw that the natural progression that I desired was still ahead of me, was still in front of me. So I went back to Central St. Martin's between 2015, 16, 17. I went back to meet with Mr. Landrum and ask him to start a process to change what I thought was a wrong thing, or what I perceived deep down in my consciousness was a wrong thing. And in the whole process of doing that, I also contacted the RCA and engineered this meeting with Rebecca Fortnum and in 2017. And the following year, in 2018, I wrote her a letter, and I would like to read to you, the viewer, some parts of this letter because it adequately describes my position and it helps you to understand what I'm up against.
To recap, as mentioned just before, I went back to Central St. Martin's to meet with Alex Landrum to change what was done. My thinking was that he would do the right thing. The certificate shown earlier confirming my position as student rep for my year outlined that 1. Developed skills in personal, online, and group communication. 1. Worked alone and with others to achieve real change, and became a dedicated and motivated volunteer for the benefit of others. An example of this was when I campaigned for the CSM teaching staff. You see, in 2012, CSM was moving from Charing Cross Road in central London, its historical site where I spent my time, to King's Cross, a new development for the college's new era. In view of this move, a few teaching contracts were not being renewed, and as a result of developing close relationships with some of the people on staff, I campaigned for contracts to be renewed, and this campaign was successful in helping people to keep their jobs. Along with the enterprise of my work, I have scholastic desires. and I acted upon a natural progression by moving to further my work at the RCA. As mentioned earlier, I had a meeting with Rebecca Fortnum. And on that occasion, I took along an original art grunge painting.
When I look at where I'm coming from, I know I'm blessed, and I close my eyes and smile. Sometimes I feel like the richest man in Babylon, and I've done my best, so everything's all right inside. Oh, every morning. Oh, every morning.
Over the years, I've been developing work on the body, the landscape, and that in between. You will hear in the letter written to the RCA of an incomprehension of the proposal attached to my application.
I rise, I stare at the sun, I know it is a blessing.
This proposal is based on the production of new work about the sky, celestial bodies, and happenings, such as the sun, its movements, the moon, and such things.
So when the evening comes, I lift up my eyes to them.
I believe this is why they claim not to have an understanding.
Blessed omen, with my two hands in the air as far as I can. Yeah, as far as I can. I can, yeah. My two hands in the air as far as I can.
However, if the proposal was about the social archetype of blackness and its linchpin in history, that is, Afro-Asiatics in chain, I'm sure there will be much understanding. However, I am not inclined to reproduce such images.
Oh, every morning I rise, I stare at the sun, I know it is a blessing, yeah. Lift up my eyes to this unblessed omen. Ooh, ooh,
my life and my work is largely based on independent and verifiable research and not solely on a defunct educational system. For example, accredited research finds that the place on earth called Nigeria has cultural and civil history that is more than 2,000 years old. This is in stark contrast to the popular belief that Nigeria began in 1960. My story is our story, a story of mankind. And there needs to be balance with the life force.
Look within. So this is to the professor. Rebecca Fortnum, who was, I don't know if she still is, but who was a senior tutor in research at the School of Fine Art at the Royal College of Art, the number one institution in the world for creative research and development. Upon our meeting this time last year and the correspondence with the relevant departments as regards the nature of acceptance of my kind that is the Afro-Asiatic male, into the institution, that is the Royal College of Art, I am of the conviction that it is incumbent upon me to point out the deficiency of the status quo. For the record, and for the sake of clarity, I do not regard myself as black. Black is a color and an adjective. Hence, it is a word that inadequately comports with any part of mankind. The use of this word to designate man is the issue of foul play, and my utilization of it thus far is based on the confinement of relevance to it by entities that abound before my existence. I am man. As such, my interest as artist stretches beyond my hue. My identity resonates on more than flesh and bone. My identity is formed on the basis of the words, decisions, deeds, and outcomes of the lineages that collide to bring about the ascendancy of my form and my spirit. For a great time, there has been an overwhelming proclivity to center on the aesthetic disposition or inclination of one kind of man, so much so that equitability has been banished, evidently by force, to the diminishing of life. As an agent of life myself, neither can I find equitability in the supplanting of that one kind of man with the female of man to the diminishing of life. That is to say, in the prescient era of the whitewash in established canons of 20th century contemporary art, in my opinion, one cannot locate the pillars of ethics. And if we, as mankind, were to build such pillars in the 21st century, one can conclusively say that equitability must be observed. From the vantage point of my life, it is fair to say that my kind has been largely omitted from the discourse in contemporary art, except mostly on the occasion that a practice is based on the societal archetype of blackness. I state this as one born in the heart of the city of Westminster, and as one who has spent more than 26 years in London. I believe the RCA, the Royal College of Art, has a duty of care to heed for ethical art for art's sake. Will you take a stand and help secure a right of place within the institution to project a symbol for good? If I recall to your mind, you stated decision not to offer an interview on my most recent application was because of a lack of confidence in my proposal, and there was no concern in regard of the qualities of my work. In this story, we're now in 2018, and in 2018, some very special things happened. I was selected for a national painting prize, which is actually the longest running contemporary painting prize in the world. It's called the John Moores Painting Prize, and it was a great accolade for me to be selected for this prize, and it has changed the course of my career at the time. The reason being that, if you recall from one of the scenes earlier, I introduced you to a friend of mine called Moon Tian, who witnessed the situation of the threat I received in terms of my final graduate exhibition show. And as a result of being selected for the prize, I had a lot more attention on my work than I had previously. And one of the people that I reconnected with was Moon Tian. And we got talking about different things. And in the process of discussing, there were revelations in this, in the discussion. You see, at the time when I was giving the piece of paper with a pass on it, I was told that everyone in my year got a pass, and that only one person got a distinction. So if indeed I did appeal that particular grade, it would be difficult to achieve anything other than that. But in my conversations with him, he said to me that he got a merit. Now, I hadn't for many years, between 2012 and that present time in 2018, I hadn't thought in the terms of getting a merit. I had thought in terms of the distinction that I was denied and the pass that I was given, right? So when he told me, I asked him if he would be so kind to volunteer all the documents that he received from Central St. Martin, and he was so kind to do so. Now, an interesting thing is that at that graduate show, right, Moo's aunt, right, and family members were very taken by this painting. Here's Moo with my mother from an exhibition sometime. 2011. Moo applied to the RCA, to the Royal College of Art as well in 2018. But he applied to do a master's degree in sculpture. You see, this painting here is not only a painting, it's what you would call a combine, right? Because it combines painting and sculpture. And Moo, who was originally a painter, decided to go from being a painter to a sculptor, and he cites this painting as the inspiration for his switch. When he told me that he got a merit, and after he sent all his documents to me, the first thing I did was go into my files and try to corroborate all the documents that he had with all the documents that I had. It turns out that out of the four pieces of paper that he was given as a confirmation, effectively a receipt, only one of those pieces of paper, one of those documents, tallied with my document, which was the official certificate confirming the degree. He had another document, which is a letter from the dean of the School of Art at Central St. Martin's College of Fine Art, confirming his grade, which I never received. Now, the letter that I'm talking about from the dean is addressed to him in Beijing, in China. Right? I live in London, about 3 miles or so away from the college, from Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design, and I didn't receive that letter from the dean. He also has a transcript and another piece of documentation, which I don't have. Now, I do have a transcript, but but my transcript is dated on a different day. It is a completely different document. It has no resemblance to the document, the transcript that Moon Tian was given. This was a bombshell of a revelation for me, because on the face of it, it then seemed that I was given an inconsistent document, which has contributed to keeping me stagnant, at least until the John Moores Painting Prize came along. I wrote to Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design, and I wrote to the authorities who were responsible for the college, which is the university body itself, University of the Arts, London. And it was a letter citing the discrepancies and querying the fact that two people who went to the university, the college, Central St. Martin's, at the same time and graduated at the same time, how is it possible that those two people can have two unidentical pieces of document confirming their time at the college?
Here, I want to take you through the documents that I speak of. This is Moo's copy of a letter from the dean that I never received. As you can see, it's addressed to him in Beijing, China. At the bottom of the letter, it's signed by Mark Dunhill, the Dean of the School of Art, and addressed from 1 Granary Square, the new site of CSM. Here is the transcript that Moo was given. As you can see, in comparison to the transcript that I was given, they're two very different documents. Let's play a game of spot the difference. On the bottom of mine, on the right hand side, University of the Arts London is noted along with its 6 colleges below it. On Moo's, it's the Central St. Martin's College alone and University of the Arts London below it. At the logo area, University of the Arts London and Central St. Martin's is noted in red, and the stars are grey. On mine, University of the Arts London is in navy blue. There is no CSM notification, and the stars are multicoloured. I'm just going to enter the CSM notification myself here. My date of birth is highlighted on this document. However, there is no date of birth detail on Moo's transcript. There's also a notification detail called a HESA reference number. I wonder, what is a HESA reference? And Moo doesn't have a HESA reference number on his document. This whole top section does not match the section on Moo's document, and to me is very bogus, in my opinion. As you can see on Moo, after the top title and middle and top section, there's an award date stated as the 25th of August 2011. On mine, there is no award date notification, just a date of progression, and it's dated the 26th of August 2011. This is very, very unusual that we would have these documents stated as awarded on two separate days. Also, the credits of the year is repeated twice on my document, while on Moo's document it's stated once. In the main body of the text, the credits are ascending. And on mine, they're jumbled up. There is a subject title at the bottom called Award, and another beside it for a code standing for merit. On mine, it's called a degree classification and not an award. In the standard notes area, the text is very different from mine. And on mine, the standard notes are hiding underneath a main title called Assessment Description. The classification for the grade is clearly outlined on the Muse document on the front of it. There is nothing on the front of mine detailing the classification for the grade. You would have to find that on the back of the document, and here is the back of the document. It looks very convincing, but let's have a closer look. As you can see, there is no schedule for merit. And the pass grade on closer look stretches from 40 to 84. On Mu, as you can see, it's on from 40 to 69. There is also a holographic logo on the document on the right-hand side of mine. On Mu's document, it's the old address for Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design. This conclusively disqualifies the document that I was given. It does not in any way resemble the transcript that Mu was given. And the fact that I don't have the letter from the dean is a monumental oversight, one that can easily be corrected by the university. All they need to do is release the original documentation that matches the exact format of the documents that were given to Mu Tian.
Six or seven, almost 8 years now down the line, I am still fighting through legal means to gain the rightful documentation so that I can have a natural progression to my career. The university have refused to release those documents. I had to hire a solicitor, a law firm, to represent my interests, to get the university to act. And they did act. Now, my law firm is a law firm called Jolson. And the university, as a result of a subject access request, which is a legal request for all information, all personal data, the university have communicated with my solicitors and released some data, right? Now my solicitors sent me some information allegedly from the university, and they sent me a new transcript which was part of this information pack. The transcript they sent me is more identical to the one that I received originally, that is inconsistent with Mu's transcript. So it doesn't resemble anything like Mu's transcript. It resembles the transcript that is being queried. I not only have the authentic versions that was given to me, but I have authentic versions that we're giving to other peers of mine. And those versions compare exactly and are exactly identical to Moon Tian's copy. I seem to be the one with the odd copy, the odd one out, if you will.
Here, I want to take you through the events that took place and the actions of my legal representative, Jolson. But first, this is Moon Tian's transcript. Now, on the back of Moon Tian's transcript, there is nothing on it. On the other side of that page just viewed, there are no markings, no identification. This is a transcript that was given to me by CSM, University of the Arts, London. Now, following a succession of emails between myself and my legal representatives, they informed me on the 27th of February 2020 that they received a new transcript from the university and was going to forward that on. This is a copy of that email. I will now show you this new transcript. So this is the new transcript, and as you can see on first impression, it closely resembles the one that was originally given to me by the university and looks nothing like Moon Tian's transcript. We will come back to a comparison of them all. First, I'd like to show you the back of the transcript that was given to me by CSM. And compare it to the back of the transcript that was given to me by Jolson, allegedly from CSM, University of the Arts, London. At first glance, they look kind of similar, but as we get closer, we can see that, in my opinion, it's an attempt to aggravate. As previously indicated, there was no merit band on the one given to me by CSM originally. You can see on this new version, it's the same under the undergraduate schedule, whereas the degree I got was a postgraduate degree. It seems to me that this is an attempt to validate this erroneous detail. In the same token, there is still nothing on the back of Moon's transcript. Now let's go through the old transcript given to me and the new transcript given to me that resemble each other. Let's look at the logos. The first one, which is the one from Jolson, looks nothing like the logo on the one that I was originally given, which also looks nothing like the logo that is on Mu Tian's transcript. This is glaring inconsistency in all three documents. Further to this, on the new transcript is a new date, which in my mind concretizes the glaring error of the transcript given to me by CSM. You can see on the bottom half of both transcripts, it's quite different. They are not the same. there seems to be a UL stamp on this new transcript, which is absent from mine and also absent from Moon Tian's transcript. There are further discrepancies, but I need not go into it because I'm sure you are convinced that there's some funny business going on here.
Hello, my name is Yoshitaka Iwamoto, and I am a contemporary artist. I undertook the Master's in Fine Art degree at Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design between 2010 and 2011. One of my peers from this program is a contemporary artist called Damilola Oshiraja. Here are the authentic records of study and completion.
You have had a good summary of this matter. I hesitate to use certain words that you might be thinking of with regards to this matter. There is an ongoing legal matter with regards to securing my authentic documentation. You see, the only reason that I would have been given something that is more aligned with a forgery is because the original, the authentic document, has a distinction grade on it. And the only way that Mr. Landrum could have followed through on his threat, because he is not the final arbiter of the grade. All the grades of the final exam are assessed and arrived at by external examiners without our knowledge. Right? So, Mr. Landrum didn't have the power to reduce the grade of my distinction to a pass. But because he is, or he was, the course director, he had access to the stationery and had the power to make me believe that the institution awarded a pass to my excellent work. This is an aberration. It's an abominable act whereby all common sense was abandoned. I have asked the university to send me the email that they sent to my solicitors, and I have asked my solicitors to send me the email that they received from the university with all the data attached to it. They have both refused to do so. And I am left with, frankly, a mess. I am bringing this matter to your attention as the court of public opinion. I'm calling on you to share this video, to make people aware of the fact that my kind, me, you, all of you who look like me, it's clear that for many years we haven't been treated right. We haven't been treated fair. And there has been very little integrity expressed to us. I'm still facing this battle to get my documentation. I have been at this now for many years. I am in need of your support to get what is rightfully mine, what I paid for in full, because I am not owing the institution any money. I pay in full, and I should have the same as the rest, no doubt. So I have faith that as you are watching this, you are not just outraged by the unfairness, but you act either by signing this petition, clicking on any of the links that are connected to this page to do with the campaigns to support the action to change things, however small and however big. And I look forward to a tomorrow where my image can be truly accepted as an image of positivity and an image of good. I hope that you understood much of what was said there. The word equitability was repeated a number of times there. To be equitable is to be impartial and fair. And I do understand the concept of equality that has been bandied about now for almost 50 years. To me, I can't find equality anywhere. I think equality is a fool's dream. It's something that cannot be achieved. Not in this world. Not in this world. To be equal is to be amongst a body of water. To be equal is to be amongst a body of water. You have to be soluble and fluid to the point that you are unrecognizable, as in a body of water in a cup or a body of water as the ocean, right? I mean, if you look at nature, if you look at the world around us, there is nothing equal. You know, there are no two trees that are the same. There are no two pieces of rock that are the same. You know, indeed, there are no two lengths of, or bodies and lengths of water that are the same. When twins are born, they do not come out the same. They are not the same weight. You know, they're not the same height, you know, and one comes out before the other. So I personally don't believe in equality. I believe in equitability, right? Something that's fair and impartial, right? So in regards to being equal, the conversation should only be in terms of mankind. Because mankind is the seed of man. So everything that is available to any section of mankind should be available to all of mankind. That is how I see it. When we come down to the micro level, the macro level being mankind, the micro level being one man, one woman, then we're talking about equitability. Has there been a sound and equitable assessment to whatever is going on? This is the conversation that we should be having. That's why I repeat the word equitable. Mm-hmm.
When I look at where I'm coming from, I know I'm blessed, and I close my eyes and smile. Sometimes I feel like the richest man in Babylon, and I've done my best, so everything's alright inside.
Oh, every morning
I rise, I stare at the sun.
I know
it is a blessing. So when the evening comes, I lift up my eyes to this. I'm blessed, oh man, with my two hands in the air as far as I can. Yeah. As far as I can. I can. Yeah. My two hands in the air as far as I can.
So,
sure.
First of all, when was your first exhibition?
Oh, my first exhibition was a long time ago. That was 1998.
Wow.
I must have been 17. And I was very lucky. It was through a friend that I met at college whose mother was a collector, I suppose. And she also worked in the community with the church. And they were reopening a church. I think it was the Methodist Church on King's Road, and they needed something to sort of spice up their opening, and she asked me if I would be happy to exhibit at the church. Okay. In their foyer, and that was my first exhibition. It was only supposed to be for a day, but it went in for 3 weeks.
Wow, so, that's an achievement.
That just inspired me to think that I could do more. Yeah.
Where was your training? You went to St. Martin's, is that true? So.
Yes, I did, but I went to St. Martin's, I suppose, towards the tail end of my burgeoning career. I started professionally at 17. At that point, it was individual practice and development. I mean, really, the seeds to that is my apprenticeship with the artist at the age of 15. I only just finished my master's from St. Martin's in 2000, and I graduated last year, 2012.
Okay.
So yeah, I finished it in late 2011. Okay. So it's quite recent doing the MA.
Okay.
And I didn't do a BA in art. No. I did a humanities related subject, okay. Business and accountancy.
Okay.
So.
Oh wow, you've been doing quite a few different things.
Well, yeah, that was in honor of my parents, you know, just to satisfy them.
So you have all the knowledge to run your own business in all ways. You're going to show some of your paintings now. We're going to put some background music up and just enjoy that, and we'll talk a little bit about that later on. So
cool.
If we can have that up, that would be brilliant. I'm going to play another tune here, Exhibit A. Jail Electronic. You like electronic music?
Well, no, it's the name of a hip-hop artist called Jay Electronica.
Cool.
That's
okay.
His name.
That's great. Yeah. Play that.
And his own story was as curious as his narrative. The tale of his life is the tale of a writer of incredible vision, an astute analyst and pundit, a lyricist compassionate and callous, a reckless hedonist, and disaffected malcontent.
I spit that wonder rhyme, me and my conglomerates shall remain anonymous, caught up in the finest. Get that type of media coverage Obama get. Spit that Kurt Vonnegut. That blow your brain, Kurt Cobain, that Nirvana shit. Who gon' bring the game back? Who gon' spit that rainbow on the train tracks? That gold rope, that five-finger rain rap. Running with my same pack. You can find the Christ where the lepers and the lames at. Life is like a dice game. One roll can land you in jail or cutting cake, blowing kisses in the rice rain. Nice whip, nice chain, the closet is closed. The stench is like slave blood in Providence Hall. Yeah, they built my city on top of a grave. Nigga get high and watch the parade. Back in the early 90s, where they at, get the gat was a popular phrase. Bally animals and rugby was a popular craze. This the vivid memoirs of an obnoxious slave. I paved ways like Nat and Harriet. I blast on Judas Iscariot and fell off in a chariot. I'm sitting pretty, spitting flames, gripping brains. Ain't a damn thing changed.
How does he do it?
My young lad, do you ask a dolphin how it swims?
No.
Or an eagle how it flies?
No.
That's right, you don't. Because that's what they were made to do.
You are about to bear witness, my friends. It's one of the greatest technological advances in modern history.
Behold!
A confectionary behemoth.
Candyman,